So the prosecuting attorney out of the Southern District of New York wants to gag not only Brian Colfage, Steve Bannon, and their attorneys from talking about the case, but also third parties like myself from discussing the case?
Oh no.
Viva Fry, Montreal litigator turned YouTuber, and I'm just a little snazzy today because I just got out of court, and I'm not in my office today because my wife took it with the kids to go visit a friend, so I am vlogging from the roof of our house. For the regulars to the channel, you know that I usually vlog in my car in much more casual attire, but I have been in trial all week. It's just as well I need to get a little sunlight because I've been cooped up in a windowless, dingy courtroom for 5 straight days. Now, when I was in the courtroom, because I was in fact connected to the internet, I saw an interesting notification come up, which I promptly checked at the break, and it was a tweet from Mike Cernovich, which reads as follows. SDNY even wants third-party opinions banned from being shared. Congrats at the Viva Fry and Barnes Law. SDNY wants a judge to order your video not be shared on social media. And not understanding that tweet in its entirety, I saw it was referencing or retweeting another tweet below, which reads as follows. Josh Gerstein, new. Feds ask judge to warn We Build the Wall founder and Bannon co-defendant Brian Colfage to tone down angry social media posts railing against the fraud and money laundering indictment returned last week. Politico and a link. Now, for unknown reason, Josh Gerstein's original tweet has somehow disappeared from Twitter, but Cernovich's tweet is still up there, and I had to go look into this because I had no idea why I saw my face in some proceeding out of the Southern District of New York. But first, a little context. I have done now 2 vlogs on the Steve Bannon and Brian Colfage indictment. I've actually done 1 vlog and 1 live stream with Robert Barnes where we dived into the issue. Dived? Yes, where we dived into the issue and discussed it in great detail. No, it's not dived, it's dove. What is wrong with me? I've been in court for far too long, I'm sorry. In my vlog, I went through the allegations of the indictment. I broke it down and explained them, and I said it didn't really look all that good for Brian Colfage and Steve Bannon, and in my live stream with Robert Barnes, he gave me an entirely different perspective of the indictment. I'll post a link to my vlog right here. Give it a watch if you haven't seen it, and I'm gonna wait another 5 seconds because that is what is required in between cards on YouTube to post the live stream with Robert Barnes, which we did. You can watch it right here. Robert Barnes presented a very compelling argument as to why this indictment was pure political prosecution from the get-go, the weaknesses of the indictment, the political opportunity of going after We Build the Wall, and what they stand to gain from such political prosecution. Apparently, Brian Colfage shared our live stream on his Facebook or Instagram page, and apparently some people didn't like that very much. So much so, in fact, that the prosecuting attorney has written a letter to the judge, asking the judge to remind the parties of their obligations under Local Rule 23.1, and we're gonna get into all of this, but let's start with the letter. U.S. Department of Justice, United States Attorney, Southern District of New York. By ECF to the Honorable Annalisa Torres, United States District Judge. Dear Judge Torres, the government respectfully submits this letter to bring to the court's attention certain public social media posts by defendant Brian Colfage. Since his arrest in connection with this case, Colfage has repeatedly described the prosecution on social media as, among other things, quote, political, end quote. Quote, an assault on every We Build the Wall donor's freedom, end quote. A, quote, witch hunt, end quote. And an effort to take, quote, political prisoners, end quote. As the Supreme Court repeatedly has recognized, extrajudicial statements about a case like those made by the defendant can create a substantial risk that a large portion of the jury pool will be tainted by pretrial publicity. Accordingly, for the reasons stated below, the government respectfully requests that at the upcoming initial conference to be held on August 31, 2020 at 1 p.m. the court draw the party's attention to Local Rule 23.1, which contains provisions relating to extrajudicial public and media statements by the parties, and articulate any further expectations the court may have about the appropriate nature of extrajudicial statements relating to this case. Now, we are going to go over the specific provision of Local Rule 23.1 in a bit, and this letter as drafted is not really seeking any orders, it is just asking the judge to draw the attention of the parties to Local Rule 23.1, sort of like a warning before the actual motion comes down. And what are these public statements with which the prosecuting attorney takes issue? Well, let's go have a look at them, shall we? Since at least August 21, 2020, which was the day after Colfage was arrested, he has made a steady stream of public statements via posts on his Facebook account regarding this case. Heaven forbid a defendant should actually have the First Amendment rights of freedom of speech to discuss his or her case in public while they are being pursued. In total, Colfage has made at least a dozen extrajudicial statements about this case on his Facebook account, which has more than 630,000 followers and can be viewed by anyone who visits his page between the time of his arrest and today. Colfage has also streamed, quote, live, end quote, videos featuring discussions of the case on his Facebook page. The statements have typically contained expressions of opinion about the defendant's innocence and the merits of the case, among other subjects, and many of them have been highly inflammatory. The following is a sample of posts by Colfage on his Facebook page. get to yours truly, front and center in the middle of a proceeding out of the Southern District of New York. Top U.S. lawyer tells horrifying truth about why SDNY wants build the wall data. See full video on profile from Barnes Law. So you can see, as per Mike Cernovich's tweet on the subject, they don't just want to ban what Brian Colfage can say, they want to ban what he can post, including live streams of what other people can say. Who is behind me? What? Oh my god!
We got back.
That's Harry the guinea pig. I need about another 20 minutes. That's Harry the guinea pig. It's very cute. The potential effect of Colfage's post has been amplified by media coverage of them. Yeah, it's called the freedom of the press and freedom of speech. I don't even consider myself to be the press, I am just an analyst. Amplification by media coverage just sounds like a really dirty way of describing freedom of press, freedom of speech, the internet. On August 25, 2020, the government drew many of these posts to the attention of Colfage's attorney and expressed concern about their potential effect on witnesses and victims, many of whom appear to follow Colfage's social media accounts, as well as the potential to taint a future jury pool. In fact, one of the very issues raised by Robert Barnes during our livestream analysis of the indictment is that there seems to be a dearth of victims in this case. There don't seem to be any victims at all. None were listed in the indictment itself. And then we get into an allegation as to how Colfage's attorneys are big bad meanies and didn't listen to what the prosecuting attorney asked for. Unfortunately, since bringing these concerns to the attention of counsel, the posts appear to have continued unabated since that conversation, and the government has been given no assurance by counsel that Colfage intends to refrain from such statements in the future. Yeah, and rightly so. That's why it's called freedom of speech. But let's go ahead and see what restrictions on the freedom of speech Local Rule 23.1 places. Local Rule 23.1 generally prohibits extrajudicial statements of opinion that a reasonable person would expect would create, quote, a substantial likelihood that such dissemination will interfere with a fair trial or otherwise prejudice the due administration of justice, end quote. SDNY Local Rule 23.1A. The rule further provides in relevant part that statements of, quote, opinion as to the accused's guilt or innocence, or as to the merits of the case or the evidence in the case, end quote, are among those that, quote, presumptively involve a substantial likelihood that their public dissemination will interfere with a fair trial or otherwise prejudice the due administration of justice. SDNY Local Rule 23.1D7. And no need to read through the entire Local Rule 23.1 because it is a long one. I'll just flash a screenshot of it so you could read it yourself, but that is in fact what the Local Rule 23.1 says at the respective provisions. In light of the foregoing, the government respectfully requests that the court, at the initial conference scheduled for August 31, 2020 at 1 p.m., remind the parties of their obligations under Local Rule 23.1, which, as noted, contains provisions relating to public and media statements by the parties during the pendency of the case, and articulate any further expectations the court may have in this regard. The government notes that the rule further provides that the court, quote, may issue a special order governing such matters as extrajudicial statements by parties and witnesses likely to interfere with the rights of the accused to a fair trial by an impartial jury, end quote. Local Rule 23.1H. And here's the kicker. The government is saying you're not in trouble yet. We're not asking for anything yet. This is just your warning. If you continue doing what you're doing, then we might ask for something. We might ask for sanctions. The government does not seek such relief at this time, but it may do so if any defendant persists in making extrajudicial statements that are likely to interfere with the court's ability to conduct a fair trial with an impartial jury in this case. And I don't ordinarily read footnotes, but occasionally they are in fact very telling. So let's read this footnote that we see here, footnote 1. By contrast, the government has made a single short public statement by way of a press release announcing the charges issued on August 20, 2020 that complied in all respects with the restrictions imposed by Local Rule 23.1. Moreover, and consistent with its general practice, the government does not intend to make any further extrajudicial statements regarding this case, with the possible exception of future press releases announcing significant events in the case, typically limited to guilty pleas, trial convictions, or sentencing, all of which will be drafted to comport with the requirement of the rule. I think it's very telling, and there's probably a lot of very good reasons why the government does not want this file getting the spotlight of public scrutiny. But not only do I not find anything particularly offensive about Brian Colfage's public statements, I don't see how on earth he can be barred from publishing third-party discussion of this subject matter. Either way, one thing is for certain, Robert Barnes and I are definitely going to be discussing this during our next live stream this Sunday at 7 o'clock. Tune in if you are not already tuned in. Subscribe if you are not already subscribed. The link to that live stream is going to be right here. One thing is for certain, never in a million years did I ever expect to see my mug in the middle of Southern District of New York criminal court proceedings, but that being said, this is where we are, and if you like my videos and you like my content, please be sure to like, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell, drop a comment in the comment section below, because it feeds the algorithm. If you want to support the channel, all of these support links are in the pinned comment. We've got PayPal, Patreon, Subscribestar, YouTube membership, merch, lots and lots of merch. Be sure to tune into the live stream with Robert Barnes on Sunday, 7 o'clock, and follow the podcast. It's called Viva and Barnes, Law for the People, on Apple, iTunes, Google Podcasts, stuff like that. But more important than that, take care of yourselves, check in on friends and family, make sure everyone around you is doing well, and now you know your vlog. Peace out. Booyah.